Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this occasion. We gather here on this beautiful day. We thank you for the brave men and women who fought for the very freedoms that we experience and practice here tonight. We thank you for their sacrifices to our country. We pray for those from this county who are serving us both at home and abroad. We ask that you be with them. For all the departments who are present here tonight and everyone who helps to make sure that this county is a great place to live and to learn and to work in, we thank you for their hard work. Thank you for the work the commissioners do. We ask that you grant us much wisdom tonight. We ask this in your holy and precious name. Amen.
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 Thank you, David. If we could all rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. Please say with me, I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We'll call the meeting to order. I'd like to welcome everyone to first meeting of our May 2012 calendar. And at this time, I'd like to take just a minute and ask our commissioners to review the agenda and see if there are any changes to the agenda, see if there are any items on consent that you would like to be removed. You'd like the items to be removed from the consent agenda. And after reviewing that, we will entertain a motion for the approval of the agenda.
I'd like to vote D and F.
Item D, the budget amendment for the health department, and F, out-of-state travel request from the health department, will be removed from the consent. And why don't we go ahead and put those as item. Let's do that before the joint resolution. Will that work, Mr. Honeycutt?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Bill. Any others? If not, motion for approval of the agenda as amended.
Same aye.
Thank you.
Second.
Linda, thank you. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. Public comments, we have one. I'd like to call on Ms. Margaret Dameron to come forward, please.
I've changed my mind. They told me last time you can't say anything unless you put your name on there. So I put my name on just in case.
Well, thank you for sharing.
I didn't know you was going to call me the first thing before you get anything done. I don't have anything I'm saying.
Well, we're glad you're here.
What y'all said.
We're glad you're here. Next item on the agenda, any commissioners' responses to the public comments? Or any other comments you'd like to make at this time? Hearing none, we'll move to the next item, which is the agenda item we just removed from consent. Both of these involve the health department, so we will call on Barry Bass. Barry here, if you would like, please come forward and discuss the three budget amendments you have and also the health department out-of-state travel request.
Yes, sir.
Very welcome.
Thank you, Richard. Glad to be here. I guess it goes through the budget amendments in the order in which they appear in your packet. And the first item is our food and lodging environmental health money. I want to commend our staff because this is reflects the work that they did for 100% inspection rate. And these monies are additional monies. And again, it is based on their inspections. And so we received an additional $19,220, which we will go towards the items that you see listed in your packet. So I'll be happy to address any questions about any particular items. But again, these are funds that are based upon the actual visits and inspections that our environmental health staff do to our food and lodging establishments in Alamance County.
Any questions for Barry on this one, Bill? Mm. Okay. Why don't we, can we hear all the budget amendments and then vote?
Sure. Yeah.
As a group? Okay.
Okay. All right. Thanks, sir. And that was Amendment 137. 138 is $2,936. And this is based upon the number of lead poisoning cases that we have in our county. And luckily, we didn't have, I think, one. It was one elevated. So as a result of that, we received this money. And this will be used towards buying supplies related back to our lead investigations at the health department that our environmental health staff does.
Any questions about 138? 139?
Okay, 139, this is $77,000 that we're receiving through the Division of Public Health. And basically what we're doing is supporting their activities in terms of funds that are going to be collected to a motivational training related back to family support teams throughout North Carolina. The actual registrations will go through the Southern AHEC, which is in Fayetteville, and we agreed to be the fiscal agent. And so they will collect like two different checks across the state. They'll send it to us, and we will pull these monies down and pay them back out of that. So it doesn't involve any money from Alamance County. It's simply we're working as an agent of the state to assist them in this training project.
What is this? Can you explain that a little bit, Barry?
All right. So what it is, it's like an interview. It's motivational interviewing that we're going to be using through our case management program and our child coordination for children program and our pregnancy medical home with our social workers and nurses in our particular county who go out and do the home visits. And so this is training to help them assist the families and how to do interviewing techniques and be I guess sensitivity in terms of working with them, and also in terms of the support teams in each county. So there are approximately I think about 1,800 people who are registered across the state to attend these various trainings. So they'll send their registration into the Southern AHEC, and then when they get all those things together, they'll send us an invoice and we'll pay them out of these funds. So it actually, we're a participant in this. I think Alamance County, we're roughly going to receive about $4,000 of our own, but this is again the training money from across the state.
So our people train the people?
No, sir. We're just acting as a fiscal agent here for the funds. We take the funds and then we'll be the repository, and then whenever the registrations come into Southern AHEC, then they're going to send us the invoices and we'll pay them back the money, which is again state funds. Yes sir.
And how did we get awarded that distinction?
Well, basically we were asked to do it as part of our relationship with the Division of Public Health.
Other questions? If there are no other questions, this is an action item, a budget amendment, 137, 138, 139 is outlined by Barry. If there are no other questions, is there a motion to approve these amendments?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Yolanda, any other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Your item, out-of-state travel request.
Yes, sir.
Can you address that for us?
Absolutely. Yes, sir. This is related back to the project launch monies that we've just received. And this is to assist our local wellness coordinator, who's Martha Kaufman, and Ann Maleski, who's with the Partnership for Children, to go to this. It's basically a required training as part of the grant. As you all may remember, the actual project launch grantee with SAMHSA is the State of North Carolina Division of Public Health, and we are the local project that has been funded for this. And as part of the training that's required, is we have to send our folks, and we've elected to send the one person who's a county employee, and Ann Maleski, again, works for the nonprofit with the Partnership for Children, because she's been a very active community partner in working with us and working with the relationships with the two medical practices. You may remember the Burlington Pediatrics and with the folks at Piedmont Health Services that we're going to be doing, where we have the behavioral health specialist working with a family partner and integrating behavioral health into primary care. So we're going to be going, to Washington, actually to Maryland, to attend this conference to, first of all, learn more about the project launch, because as you remember, this is the first year that Alamance County has been involved, which is actually the third year of the grant. So we're coming on board and learning like expectations, and also looking at what are some of the other best practices that are going on in the country. I think the real key to this is that I'm feeling confident that the project that we're doing here in Alamance County is going to be actual model for the rest of the country. We've been really well pleased how we've been able to integrate ourselves with our local practices, as well as with Alamance Alliance, in terms of the delivery of these behavioral health services services to families and children. So this is the opportunity for them to go to Maryland to hear the different other programs going on across the country. I think it's basically 2.5 days. This is to support them and their activities in order to enhance our project launch and the services that we're providing along with that.
What's the history of that grant?
This grant is, this is actually only the third year of it. This was, and it is a grant that is designed to look at how to use behavioral health from a public health model and doing like public health kinds of preventive services. As you may remember, the Alamance Alliance grant, the other SAMHSA grant that Alamance County has, does with intervention and treatment services. And what these services do with LAUNCH, and LAUNCH stands for linking unmet needs for children's health, to do it from a preventive aspect, to try to do early identification, like whenever the one is, we go back like to work with the moms and when they're pregnant, and even doing preconception health to have good pregnancy outcomes. And then when the babies are delivered, to make sure we, if there are early behavioral problems indicated, that we can get those children and their families to the resources. So this is a grant that's only been existed, I think this is maybe the third or fourth year. So it's a fairly new grant. And part of what we're doing, one of the most important components is an evaluation piece where, you know, we're going to be doing like empirical evidence to have like a baseline, and when parents, you know, their knowledge levels before they come into the program and then during the program and then when they exit, so we can say, well, has this been an effective intervention in terms of what we're doing in Alamance County? And that will be the same for each of the projects in the country, and I think there are about 20 of those. So, you know, to do a comparative on those data as to what particular program models may be working better than others.
Is this the same thing we were talking about?
This is, we are kind of the secondary recipient from Guilford County.
That's correct. We inherited the grant from Guilford County because they were having, for whatever reason, it's one of those life's great mysteries as to how it wasn't exactly working well. But we've taken this project on, and it's really been impressive, the amount of work that's been accomplished over the last 4 months since November. And I mean, the fact that we brought these, you know, the work relationship with the Alliance, with the Partnership for Children, and again with the primary care practices, in terms of having their buy-in to allow the behavioral health specialists to be co-located in their practices. So
Guilford got the initial grant and then basically decided they didn't want to.
Well, for whatever reason, it didn't fly. And then we were asked to do it because of the other work that had been going on here. And I think that's the thing that I found most impressive, is that we've really hit the ground running, and the amount of work that's transpired. I was a bit hesitant at the first we took it on, thinking it may be more than we'd bitten off more than we can chew.
Do you know how much they spent of it versus what we inherited?
No, sir, I don't know. The grant itself, if you include the different components, is somewhere around $400,000 a year for us over, you know, for this year.
The next 3 years?
Yes, sir. Yeah. And again, we'll have like two positions that are actually county-funded positions with the grant. The other parts of it we're doing contractually with the practices and such.
And if the board's aware, the two positions that are county funded with the grant, those are time sensitive.
That's right. Mr. Lashley asked that. We built that into the. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I don't have a problem with this. I mean, at least they're not sending 10 people to D.C. But I would like to know the details of Guilford, what they spent, and basically why did he quit and give it to us? I mean, it's not every day a government agency says, I don't want the money, I'll give it to some other county. Unless maybe it doesn't work after all.
I don't think that, based on what I've seen, I don't think that's the case. I just think there were some problems, and maybe I can drill down tomorrow. A couple of the program folks are going to be here for another issue, and I can get some information.
Tim, and maybe I don't know if this is totally it, but the Alamance Partnership for Children, they have been very active with a lot of the local medical centers, and maybe it's that end of it might be working better. I know Canoda West, they're doing programs, doing a lot of stuff in the medical centers that maybe Guilford wasn't as fortunate to have the reception on that end.
I think that's a large part of it, that, you know, the collaboration that goes on here amongst the medical providers, as well as the, you know, what's already been established, I think put us in a good position. So you know, I'm thinking that, if you will, that so far we've really played well together as a group in our community. And there's
smaller community maybe makes it work easier.
And the collaboration, yeah. I think that's a very good point, Commissioner Boswell, that there's this spirit here of we're going to work together and make it work, and we don't have a lot of the turf issues and perhaps some of the silos that appear in other communities, that there really is a good sense of collaboration and cooperative working together here. And I think that may have been part of what they ran into, was that, you know, that folks wanted it done one way or another, and they couldn't quite come to terms, whereas, you know, we're willing to find out what it is that's going to work and figure out a good middle ground and work from there. So,
well, just a comment. This whole program has been great. The SAMHSA grant, as well as this one. I was on Partnership for Children, too. And everybody does work together. I mean, everybody pulls their load. And I've been involved with it for the last 3 years, and it is certainly a benefit to Alamance County. I just have to say, the SAMHSA grant is a benefit to Alamance County because it helps a lot of kids from 0 to 5 that had problems. And if you look at a chart that Gary had, it showed you where these kids were and where they started, where they are now, and it's just been a great benefit for Alamance County.
And that's going to be part of, again, of our evaluation component. One of the other things, too, that was made quite clear is that we're going to have to be able to pull out, you know, as best we're able, those two grants, even if they're very similar, you know, how the differences and all are working in terms of, the, you know, again, that's why the data and evaluation components are critical.
Given Barry's explanation, is there a motion to approve this out-of-state trip?
So moved.
Second.
Bill, any other comments or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you very much, sir. Appreciate you, sir.
Next item on the agenda deals with the joint resolution for the creation of an area authority. And I'm going to begin speaking about this because it does involve the continuous process of the transition of the LME, that's the local management entity, as it relates to the administration of mental health here in Alamance County. I was a member of the LME board for this year. I took the position after Linda had served in that capacity and had watched kind of the evolution and transition from how mental health services are administered in Alamance County. Not the providers, not the folks that are the recipients of the service or the providers that are providing that service, but rather the administration of the oversight, the billing, and so forth. Briefly, the state passed a law indicating that if certain levels of a population weren't in a certain entity, there was strong incentive to merge. And Linda helped me out, but in our situation, we lost about 2 years ago Rockingham County from what was Rockingham County, Caswell County, and Alamance County that basically were covered by our local management entity. Population threshold dropped below 200,000, and therefore we were forced by law to seek a merger partner. And a lot of shopping around was done, and a lot of interesting interviews were held, but ultimately the decision of the local management entity was to merge with PBH out of Concord, North Carolina. And I'd like to recognize and introduce Ms. Pam Shipman, who is here with us tonight. Pam is the Chief Operating Officer of PBH. We welcome you and appreciate the way that your group has handled the transition, certainly as it relates to the folks that are receiving services and the providers that you're working with. So we welcome you. We do have other members of the PBH board newly assigned. David Carter and John Moon are both with us as well, and they are members of that board as I think I'm still registered as being a member of that board as well, again, during the transition, which is what we want to talk about tonight. PBH has done a very good job of expanding and integrating different counties in their prior functions into their organization, and currently has a coverage area that includes 15 counties. I won't name them all, but those counties include Alamance and Caswell, and a lot of folks that are our neighbors. In connection with that, current law provides that three members from each county serve on the PBH governing board. And that's fine when PBH had two, three, maybe four counties, but with 15 counties, that results in the governing board totaling 45 members. Tony, that would be 3 times 15, would to get us our 45. So, and those of you that serve and attend and review boards, there's not a whole lot of discussion, typically interaction in a 45-member board. There may be a lot of information, but in terms of board interaction, discussion, and really working on actions, that tends to be a little large, perhaps a little unruly, I guess, depending on the board members are, who the board members are. The result is that PBH has been working with the state to propose legislation that would allow for a new governance model. This model would cut the membership currently served by the 15 counties from 45 members down to a 13-member board. This number 13 would be providing enough representation from the counties that are being served, along with certain folks that are considered experts in their field. And again, if we want to delve into who those 13 people would be, I'm sure that Pam could help us out with that and the rationale behind that. The reason that it's on the agenda tonight is PBH has asked each of the 15 counties to consider a resolution that would support this Board of Governance model. This would have to be considered by state legislature and probably will be considered during this short session. And to date, 12 of the 15 counties have signed the resolution that we have been reviewing. The ones that haven't include us and Caswell County and Davidson County. My understanding is Caswell County is scheduled tonight to meet and have the same discussion that we are. I want to also state that our county attorney is not in favor and has not recommended that we go ahead and pass this resolution at this time. And I don't want to speak for the county attorney. I'm not a lawyer, but basically what Mr. Albright's position in looking at his concerns are that we are passing or would be passing a resolution that in itself is not allowed by law. And in talking with the folks from PBH, the support that they get from the counties who are involved will allow it to perhaps become law. So it's a little bit of the which comes first, but Clyde has eloquently outlined his concerns, and we all have had the opportunity to review those. It's my position, after serving on the LME board and watching the transition, that I think it's in Alamance County's best interest to move this process along as quickly as we can to allow PBH to gather the support they need to affect the change at the state level. I also want to emphasize that the resolution that we're reviewing here really doesn't have anything to do with the final dissolution of our LME. We have some issues out there that are winding down. I think we are still on schedule with that issue to hopefully be complete by the end of our fiscal year, June 30th of this year. So it really doesn't have anything to do with that. It really has to do with our participation and support of the proposed PBH governance structure, which again would change the board membership from 45 individuals from 15 counties down to 13 individuals that would include representation from the 15 counties, but on a rotating basis, as well as some other folks that would support their board. That's really what I have to say, and would be happy to have Linda, if you'd like to speak to it, or other commissioners, or if there are questions that we want to discuss it. But that is pretty much it. I will say that with this resolution, if it is passed, we intend to give Pam and the folks at PBH a copy of Mr. Albright's reservations to the current status of this resolution, so that they may have further information that they could use perhaps when they're talking to the state folks later on this spring.
Well, I would like for Mr. Albright to, since everybody doesn't know about his concerns here, would you elaborate on some of these, like, sure. That's in your letter?
Well, the main
that's
concern...
That's okay.
Sure.
Main concern that I have is that we're getting ahead of the state legislature. There's a subcommittee meeting this week to discuss governance issues. And I agree with PBH as far as the current law not being adequate. Because the state legislature created PBH last year, and the law that they used for governing LMEs was a statute that was passed about 10 years ago. So it doesn't fit the current organization that we have. But my concern is that this resolution that they're asking to pass asks the board to grant powers, certain powers that the legislature has not given this board to grant. And that's my major concern about it. And I would suggest waiting on the legislature to come up with the rules and regulations and laws that you can give to PBH at the appropriate time.
Don't you have the resolution worded to be compatible with that theory?
I do. I do have one.
Well, I mean, that's not what we're looking at.
No.
Well, and the issue there, Tim, is that if you've reviewed the signature page of the resolution, the concern that PBH has that if we alter the proposed resolution, then it would have to be routed back to the other 12 counties that have already reviewed it and signed off on it. But valid question, certainly. Other comments or questions?
Well, it's just concerning. I mean, it's only two other counties that haven't signed on. Is that correct?
That's my understanding. Is that still accurate?
Yes, and I've been told that Caswell will proceed to pass this tonight.
So what repercussions could we have from this?
Well, having a resolution without the authority to grant it, if Cardinal Innovations does come into existence, there may be some issues about contract and authority and what they've done in the interim. If the state of North Carolina does not pass governing legislation in the manner contemplated by this resolution, then you're going to have to address it again.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
You said we'd have to
address it again. If the state if says, happened. No, you can't do that, county.
Then it would come back to us.
So it just has to come back through the whole process.
So it would just come back through the whole process.
And if in the interim somebody sues PBH or claims they didn't get the services they're getting, and PBH says, well, we're now Cardinal Innovations, that could cause some problems. I mean, there's enough confusion to go around in this LME reorganization. And the legislature agrees that there is a lot of confusion. That's why they're addressing it and trying to come up with new rules.
To me, it doesn't seem like it's something that needs to be done right now. You know, if we don't have the legal authority to grant this situation or this group, I don't think we need to do it.
Other comments?
Tom, could we have Ms. Shipman come and speak to where they are in the legislative process?
Would you like to do that?
She has that.
Are you comfortable?
Ability.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm Pam Shipman. I'm the CEO at PBH. I don't know who I need to tell. Just to comment briefly on a couple of issues that were raised. The current statute allows the counties of an LME to form an alternative governance model. For example, Western Highlands has 8 counties, and they all voted to do something different than is specified in the current statute. I think they have like a county manager and another person. I can't remember if it's a county commissioner or a citizen from each county on their board. So they have developed an alternative structure similar to what we're proposing to do, where, you know, they had 8 counties, they decided they wanted to do it differently than what they had been in the past, and the current law allows that. Now, Clyde Albright is correct. There is a committee in the General Assembly that is looking at the 122C statute because it's very old and very out of date and really doesn't fit, you know, the system anymore, where you have regional LMEs. You know, it really was meant for much smaller entities or single county LMEs, and so there are a lot of problems with it. And he's had a work group working on it and various and different ideas presented about, you know, what about this, what about this, what about that. And the last meeting is next week. He has not released any his bill as to specifically what he would recommend the General Assembly address this year. My understanding is that he will propose some very limited changes in the law for the short session, with the idea of going back at it again in a long session with maybe some more comprehensive changes. However, right now, unless he gets changed, you know, the boards of commissioners for the participating counties can elect to form an alternative model and board composition. But the need to have this done is every time an LME like PBH adds counties, we have to bring a resolution back before every county to be reapproved. So last fall or last summer, when we added Alamance and Caswell counties, you know, we had to have a resolution that went from Alamance and Caswell and then all the five PBH counties. July 1st, we'll be adding eight counties, the ones from Orange, Person, Chatham, and then the five counties that form the five-county LME, which are north and on the Virginia border, Vance, Warren, Granville, Halifax. And those, and so we have to have a resolution from all those 15 counties, you know, again, allowing those counties to come into the PBH LME. So this resolution does a number of things. You know, it allows those other counties to come in, and they are in the process of dissolving their boards. We have been operating them under contract since January 1st, and so, you know, they're on a timeline to shut down. So July 1st, you know, we do really need to include them in our business, you know, as a part of PBH. We are changing our name July 1st to Cardinal Innovations. The reason that we chose to do that is because, you know, we're really not PBH anymore. You know, we wanted a name that would represent all the counties. You know, we didn't want it to be like, well, PBH is going to take over everybody else, and, you know, it's going to be our way, no way. And so we wanted to change our name. Also, as part of that, we've had a work group that has worked since October, where we had three or four members of each board and the CFAC chairs come together and talk about, okay, we know 45 is too many people to be on a board. What would be another way of maintaining a connection to the community while at the same time having a board that's a reasonable size that can really make decisions and get things done? And so the model that's described in your resolution is a result of that work group, where they came up with the idea of having community oversight boards at the local level. Those boards would choose someone to be on the governing board. It could be their chair, or they could choose another party from their team to be on the oversight board.
And Pam, I think we all have this.
You have that, okay. Yeah. So that's kind of the model that the work group came up with, and that's presented in the resolution in, you know, more legal type terms. I don't know what's going to be in Representative Dollar's, you know, proposed revision to the legislation, you know, and I don't know exactly when it would come out, when it would be passed. And so what we're working towards is thinking, okay, July 1st, we've got to have a board, we've got to have a governing authority for these other eight counties. And so, you know, it takes a long time sometimes to get things through. And so that's why we've started working now, so that, assuming that this all passes, we can pull together a planning committee for this new board that, you know, will succeed the PBH current board that we have now, that includes three people from Caswell and three people from Alamance on it at the moment. So we have a 21-member board right now. You know, we need to do some planning for that board, you know, to move to this new model before July, if possible. And so, you know, we are wanting to do that so that it smoothly operates. PBH is not really going away. We are changing our name, and we're getting bigger with the addition of the new counties.
Was this a generic resolution that was the same everywhere?
No. The counties, there's a number of counties across the state that are merging, and the resolutions would be unique to, you know, each set of counties and whatever their arrangement is. I know Durham and Wake. Oh, yes, within our group, yes. It's the same resolution went to all the counties.
Staff on your end?
Our attorney prepared it. We had it reviewed and passed by all of the LME boards. So each LME board looked at it and approved it before we took it back to the commissioners for approval.
Would he be the lead representation firm for any challenges on this?
Yes, he's in-house. He's in-house, and so he would be our in-house counsel.
That's Richard Tommy.
Richard Tommy. Mm-hmm.
You may have heard that name.
Yeah, he's our in-house counsel.
So let me ask a question, if you don't mind. If you're talking about a governance board of 13 members, you got all these new ones coming in. Is that going to change that?
No, that would be how we would. Included. Right. Well, you would have oversight boards that would have representatives that would come up to the governance model. So that, you know, you would have both your community connection as well as a reasonably sized board at the top.
Which would be the 13 members.
Yes, yeah, ma'am.
And that actually is outlined in this.
Yeah, I saw that.
The picture, yeah, okay, right. Got it.
Drawing there.
Yeah, but it doesn't address all the different counties. So.
Okay. I'm good with it. That's.
Were you in a position to make a motion?
I would like to make a motion that we do move forward with this because I think, like you said earlier, it's kind of which comes first. And I think, and looking at her letter too, back and forth, Clyde, I mean, we realize if it goes to legislation and it doesn't do what it's supposed to, you're going to have to readjust your outline here. So
that's right.
I don't really see the downside to moving forward and get this behind us and let you guys do what y'all need to do to get it like you want it. I'll make that a motion.
Second. Thank you, Eddie. Tim, any other discussion? Pam, you may want to hold on. I guess I would ask the board's permission that if this is approved, can we have it accompanied by Clyde's list of reservations, not as part of the resolution, but just as additional information so that Richard's group can review it. Is that
right? I think that would be
right.
Proper to do that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda, County Manager Report. Craig Honeycutt, you've got budget options for fiscal year 2012-13 and discussion and update on excess county property.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And again, thank you for letting me present the budget to you tonight. And what we've done from our meeting that we had last month, our workshop on April 2nd, we've kind of taken some of those thoughts and ideas and redefined. We've got some better revenue figures also at this point. We've worked on a couple of different options with departments and looking at possible cuts. So we're just going to present this to you as possible options for the next year's budget.
Do we have hard copies of this?
No, sir. I apologize. We'll make sure you get it by the end of the meeting. So, because I was working on this till about 5:30 this evening. So this is what we presented on April 2nd at our workshop, estimated through June 30th, 2012. This is for this current fiscal year. We were projecting revenues at $122 million and expenses at $124, meaning we would use about $2.6 million in revenue. As we talked about earlier, a lot of our sales and services are down, a lot of our tax collections are down to a certain extent, so we're down a little bit on our revenue projections. We thought we were going to use about $2.6 million in fund balance this year. As of April 30th, we've done some revisions, and we've lowered that a little bit to $2.4 million. So it's moving at least in the right direction as far as not using as much fund balance. But what does that mean? Fund balance July 1, 2011 was 10.9%. If we go as projected, and again using $2.4 million in fund balance this year, our fund balance will be a little over 9%. And again, 8% is the minimum required under the state's general statute. again, what's changed from April 2nd with respect to revenue? Sales tax coming in a little bit better. We've adjusted the budget up by $400,000. Again, the tax discount that was approved by the board at our last meeting of $551,000, we were able to add back to it. We did not add lottery debt service, and that's paying for the shortfalls for our sales tax. One of the big things we did not add was misdemeanor revenue. And we've done a lot of talking about the misdemeanors and that we're holding misdemeanors at $40 a day. Right now, we're holding approximately 45, if I believe that's right. So if you budget that, we looked at about 41 per day has been an average at $40 a day times 365. That's almost $600,000. And then other increases to other revenue line items, about $400,000. At this time, we've not added a property tax increase, but we wanted to show you what 1 cent would equal. So 1 cent is $1.2 million. But the top is what we feel very comfortable in adding back to our current, our proposed revenue stream.
Craig, before you leave that slide, last fall, we had talked about the possibility of requesting amounts in the current fiscal year. We didn't do that then, and none of that is included in whatever happens between now and June 30th. Is that correct?
Not sure if I understand the question.
It was either in September or October, you proposed the idea that we could
cut the 5% cut to outside agencies
in the current fiscal year.
In the current fiscal agency, that's not included.
Okay. And
we
didn't do that.
We did not do that.
Okay.
We did not do that. That would have been about $1.8 million, if I'm not mistaken. So if we did a 5% cut to outside agencies in this year's budget,
it's about $2 million.
So then fund balance usage, instead of being 2.4, would only be around 400,000. So, and again, just to a reminder, we were requested of $130 million as far as budget requests. In our revised revenue projections, we have $122 million. That leaves us in the red about $8.174 million. And either we have to do that in cuts or new revenue to balance. And again, we're not recommending any fund balance usage because we're getting down to the state minimum.
I want to make sure that we all understand. So the difference has been cut by $3 million. Because when we met before, you were at 11.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So right. Those are revenues that we've added. Right.
So we've shrunk the gap.
We shrunk the gap. Yes, sir. Okay. The misdemeanors, the lottery revenue were the big pieces of that. So $8.174 million. And again, go back to the jail revenue, the misdemeanor program. When we asked from the Sheriff's Department about revenue, they just started this program in January. And in January, we may have had 10 misdemeanors in all month. So the revenue numbers were not there. They were not included. However, we've looked at it. The average April stay has been about 45 per day. We have 46 as of today. And again, that estimated revenue is about $600,000. So with that being said, we talked about the annex and should we shut the annex because of ICE being down and the Marshals prisoners being down. We didn't include the misdemeanors. The recommendation at this point is the misdemeanors should cover basically the salaries of those people down at the annex. So therefore, by keeping the annex and keeping it open, it gives us that flexibility in case those Marshals or ICE prisoners do come in. So at this point, we're recommended that we do keep the annex open. Again, this is where we're at April on our Marshal and our ICE prisoners. Average of 70 in April, 24 ICE, and this is as of today, there were 74 and 15. But again, the annex gives us the flexibility. If we shut the annex, we lose all our flexibility. Sheriff's Administration, I really do appreciate working with the sheriff on this. One of the big things that I think there was a concern about is our contract with Langford Security. They've done a good job for us, but the contract is about $205,000. In talking with the sheriff believes that through his existing personnel, either through existing jailers or existing part-time personnel, he should be able to cover courthouse security and be a little bit more flexible than I guess Langford can be as well. That's saving $205,000. One of the big capital needs that we do have, though, is cars for the sheriff's department. The county, other than his use of drug forfeiture money, the county really hasn't put a lot of money toward its cars in the last 4 years. So the thought process, if the board's agreeable, is we would take the savings from Langford that he's willing to absorb and put that into capital. So that'd be $200,000 we would put to capital. Providing courthouse security would not require additional positions or additional funding. ABSS fund balance. This has been a big issue for the last couple of years, and understand their thought process of wanting to have a large fund balance, but it is a large fund balance. Currently, as of July 1, 2011, they had $21.5 million in fund balance. They are looking at appropriating $4 million for fiscal year 12-13, and they've allocated $10.5 million this year. $4 million was for technology, and $6.5 million was to balance the budget. And in looking at their March 1 figures, and we don't have April's yet, they've only spent $5 million of that fund balance. If I'm a betting man, and the school system is here, and they may disagree, I don't think that they're going to use all of the $10 million that they've budgeted for fund balance. So that means that they will be putting $5 million back into fund balance. So that would still leave them, even taking out the allocation this year, still leave them, if I, 17, 15, still a lot of money. I didn't back it out. But it still leaves them the flexibility in their fund balance where we don't have. Again, I think it's interesting also to look at the history of school funding and the fund balance. And we look just at the last 5 years. If you look at 07-08, the allocation was $31 million, $31.4 million. That year, they increased their fund balance by $1.7 million for a total of $10 million. The next year, they requested an increase of $2.7 million, even though they put money in the fund balance the year before, to make that $34.2 million. By the end of the year, they added an additional $4 million to fund balance. So it was our increase of $2.7 million, but then they added another $1.4 million above what we gave them as an increase. In 9-10, we gave them an increase of $657,000. They added $4.8 million to fund balance. So again, that's how we see the fund balance going up from 10 to 14 to 18. In 10-11, there was an increase of $400,000 to their allocation. Fund balance still went up $3.3 million. So again, they've had the flexibility in the fund balance. 11-12, we did cut them back over $1.7 million, but we're unsure of where that fund balance will end between now and June 30th. But again, they're budgeting to use 10.6. I don't believe you know, just my opinion, I don't think they're going to use the $10.6 million. I think they'll still put part of that back in the fund balance. And again, we've increased their funding in the past 5 years by over $2 million. Just general allocation. And that includes subtracting the $1.7 million we cut them this year. Their fund balance still went up $14 million. And again, the increases we've given them, they basically have put in the fund balance.
Whoa. Before you leave the schools, where are you in your discussions with the administration about a fund balance policy?
Haven't heard anything as far. You know, we gave them a recommendation about a year ago. We've not received any positive response back saying let's work on this.
Well, now, when we all met with them, was it December?
December, I think it was. We talked about that.
That was one of the things that we left.
Right.
So you might want to just follow up and see where they are on that. Right. I'd like to know that before we move too far forward.
Right. Okay, any questions on that at this point?
And they're not required to carry any fund balance, is that correct?
No, we're their fund balance. We're part of our 8% or our 9% now covers is their fund balance as well as their allocation.
Well, you might want to explain that a little bit.
For every department that we have, that we budget, we have an allocation, we have to carry 8% of a fund balance.
We give for a total allocation. Million, we have to hold 8%.
We have to hold 8% in reserve.
The fund balance is based on our total annual operating budget.
Right. And they're part of it.
30-some million.
Is part of it.
So 8% of 30 million is 2.4 million.
Right.
So $2.5 million in the fund balance is in reserve. In essence, for the school.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
One of the things we talked about is increasing revenue. We've talked about, and this has been discussed by the Parks and Rec Commission as well, is we don't charge fees for athletics. You know, I think we've had this discussion with the board, with the city of Burlington charging outside of city residents $95 per child. We thought we were going to get a large influx of teams. It didn't work out that way this year, but it's something we need to look at and kind of being equitable on the club scene. You know, we have a lot of club ball, but being equitable across the board is looking at $20 per child, $15 for multiple children, looking at a fee waiver proposal that if somebody has a specific need and a financial burden that's too much, we would work with them on that. But again, it was approved by the Recreation and Parks Commission. And initially, we're looking at not a lot of revenue, but about $12,000. But again, that's something.
Well, you know, what's the city of Burlington fee for their children?
Again, we would look at recommending an increase or to implement fire marshal inspection fees. This is only for re-inspections only. Many times our fire marshals have to go back to do re-inspections. And there's a cost to that, you know, for those re-inspections. If you have a clean bill of health, I guess, your first inspection, there is no charge. But if we have to continually come back, you know, we're recommending that a charge be added to that. And again, what have we done as a county? You know, we've talked about cuts and where we're at and you know, have we put that extra notch in our belt? If you look at 08, the adopted budget, general fund budget was $77 million, 77.7. And 12 is almost $70 million. That's a difference of $7.7 million. But if you see our outside agencies have had a 7% increase over that time. Also, we've had an increase of 37% to our restricted programs. And again, just some footnotes at the bottom, we're looking at an additional 2% cut internally this year. There's some departments that are so small that are like 1- and 2-person departments that we're already to the bone. We'd have to cut lights off for good, that we may not be able to get the full 2%. But that's what we're working on. Again, that would be 11.3% cut since 08. And again, our largest outside agency increases over this period was the school system, the community college, and the airport. So that's where those major increases are. And again, if we look at our restricted programs, since 08, we've added $1.7 million in new debt. We've added grants for $2.4 million, and then other fixed costs such as insurance, health, and property have gone up as well, as long as gas and everything else. So, the question will be, what have we done internally? You know, and I think through the hard work of finance and our department heads that we really have taken the cuts very seriously. Again, and this is something we talked about in April, what have we done? This is not the full list, but I just thought I would throw it up here as well. Here's what we've done in the last 3 years, from furlough days to no COLA raises, mid-year budget cuts. Our full-time equivalent staff has gone down. We've refinanced bonds. Again, I had about 3 pages, from our budget retreat. Of cuts and things that we have done to try to be more efficient. And again, one of the things we talked about is we've had increased requests from our external agencies. And if we cut and take out the increases that they've requested, that's a savings of $2.2 million for all outside agencies. A thought process may be to cut them an additional 6%, and that would be an additional $2.3 million in savings. Again,
but that additional 6 does not, it's not inclusive of your request till end of this, right? In other words, what you think you might have to do, we might have to do.
Well, not for this year. Not for this year. Oh, this is for next year.
Oh, okay.
This is for next year.
Well, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, we can approve possibly the net request if we go the additional 6. Is that?
We, yeah. Basically, yeah, yes,
12%.
Sir. 12%.
Yeah. Outside
agents. Right.
I just want to know what all my
options.
How many bullets I got?
all the variables coming together. Yeah.
And again, we're looking at cutting capital outlay internally. There was a $550,000 request from the Sheriff's Department. Again, we would put back $200,000 for Langford. EMS was requesting a couple additional ambulances. We would cut that. And then all of the department's capital was $80,000. One of the things that really came up and was a direction from the board at the last meeting was to look at what we could do for our employees. Since we've had furlough days, we had a week again in the 9-10 budget. We had 2 days this year, or 10-11 and 2 days this year, which really resulted in 2% pay cut and 1% pay cut. We hadn't had employees for raises for county employees since 08, but the board asked to look at a 2% COLA raise for all employees with no furlough days and possibility of looking at 3 bonus days.
Is that in addition to, or?
Yeah, we can, either or, but we, yes, sir. And then next steps is to get feedback from the board on, is this a right direction to go? If no major changes, we can present a manager's recommended budget at our next meeting, and then at that meeting, call for a public hearing for June 4th.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Is that COLA and the three bonus, is that included in this current budget now that you're talking about?
That's an option. We haven't compiled everything yet. Okay. You know, what we're trying to do now is to get a framework.
Can you go back to that slide?
Yeah,
Right there.
Because that's $799,000. That's what I'm asking. Is that what's got to come out of the general fund to do that?
To do a 2%.
Right, to do a 2%. Oh,
okay. And is that included in what you are talking about at this point?
That's an option. And that's one of kind of the spokes. That's one of the variables.
Right.
If you're telling me that you would like to have increases for employees and try to make sure we budget for that, that's what it's going to cost you.
Okay. The furlough days you went over, you said we went from 5 to 2 to basically this would be 0.
Yes, sir.
Did you say how many bonus days we've been having?
We had 3 last year.
Didn't we have 5 one year?
5.
5, 3.
Yeah.
5 the first year, 3 last.
Okay,
year.
Yeah.
The current year.
This
right.
Year's 3.
Okay. So right. So we would keep that the same.
Right.
Under this scenario.
Right. Or we could
take
get
that.
Rid of them, you, whatever the board
says.
There's no cost. Yeah, there's no cost.
Yeah.
There's no cost associated.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Cover when
right.
They're out.
Yeah. Okay.
But the furlough days do affect the budget. Do you know what one day? I mean to put you on
400?
I think it's about 150.
150?
Total,
yeah.
Salary and benefits.
For one furlough day?
For one furlough day.
Okay, now go to your planning horizon.
Yeah, I'm through.
Let me make sure. Yeah, that's. Is to if this framework works, then we can look at formulating a final budget.
So the final budget would be discussed in here at our next meeting.
Yes, sir.
And if we come to agreement as a board, then we would vote not to approve the budget, but to approve a public hearing for June 4th, any time after of which we could approve the budget.
Yes, sir.
And what's the deadline for approval of the budget?
June 3rd.
So we have to approve it either at the first June meeting
right.
or the second.
Or a special call meeting. Yes, sir.
So would you include that cuts for the outside agencies? Is that part that you would include that, and that would be included in our budget?
Waiting for direction. And again, this is not. There is a possibility of looking at a tax increase as well. It depends on where we're at, but there is a possibility.
So,
even with all these cuts.
But that outside agency request you're talking about. You could, at the next meeting, bring us
specific
options.
Yes.
Options too.
Right. We could specifically sit on paper how every dollar lays out.
I thought we were going to get that.
Yeah. Well, with the managers recommended. And what I wanted to do tonight is just kind of give you a framework and then let me, I guess, build the house from the framework. And then we'll give you the set of floor plans at the next meeting, and then you tell me which rooms you want and don't want.
Well, I think what you need to know from us is,
yeah.
Based on what you just went through,
is this reasonable?
That feels strongly about or not about a certain
right.
item that we need to give the county manager direction on? I mean, that's what I'm hearing you saying.
Yes, sir.
Well, the only thing I can say is I'm not going to vote for an increase in taxes. I absolutely know it's not.
Well, I think it should have all, no offense, I think it should all been put in together. I mean, you know, it's like showing me something I can buy, but you're not telling me how much I'm going to pay for it. And, or, you know, i.e. the citizens. And I'm not real crazy about the way all this has come down tonight, to be quite honest about it. But I am impressed that the budget hasn't gone. I mean, our budget's the same as it was in, 2008, 2009?
Yes, sir.
We've cut.
That's impressive.
Yeah.
but I wish we'd had more pricing tonight.
Did you say the effect of the current year changes on projected fund balance for June 30th? You said it was
2.4.
Going in the right direction.
We were looking at 2.6 April 2nd, and now we're looking at 2.4.
So
we're still going to go into the fund balance this year?
At this point, yes, sir.
Unless there's a buying.
Well, it's like I said to you in private, you know, first of all, we've redlined our budget. We've redlined it to the point to where, you know, we're at the risk of being downgraded by these bonding agencies or these people who review us. I think we played with the fund balance. I think there was some reliance on the fund balance. You know, I'm not sure we didn't over budget. I mean, you know, I've had people say, you know, we've talked about this. You know, what figures were put in the budget? What kind of revenues did we say we were going to generate in certain areas? And when the patterns were obviously not there, why did we do it? And you know, it's you know, I'm not going to worry about whether I vote yes or no, depending on, you know, what anybody thinks as far as, you know, I'm going to make a decision based on what's good for the county, up or down. We've already been told that our fund balance cannot go an ounce lower. And revenue neutral 3 years ago was probably, in all honesty, 54.3. And I didn't vote for the 52 because I thought we hadn't cut enough. You know, had we known, it wasn't your fault, but had we known what true revenue neutral was, 54 would have been approved that night.
Yeah.
Well, there's any question about it. I mean, I wouldn't have voted for it, but that's not to say I'd have been right and everybody else was wrong. I'm just saying, you know, I was wanting to play it out another year. And because subsequently I had voted for 52 for 2 years. So I'm going to be honest with my vote. You know, we have got to stop the bleeding on our fund balance. And if we're downgraded, what it's going to cost us to recoup that is going to be more than any tax increase as far as on a minimal basis. But I told you, and I'm sincere, I don't want any gimmicks. I don't want any one-year solutions. I want this to be a continual budget scenario. In other words, to where we won't have to come back 2 years from now and address this situation. But that's why I was hoping we could see some pricing tonight. Because without pricing, I don't know if I want to go in and hit that 6% any further, you know, the outside agencies any further.
Well, we can always change it.
But we've done a lot in this county. I mean, when you sit back and look at 21 counties that we're in the population range of, from 99,000 to 249,999, and you see that out of 21 counties, there's only five counties that's got a lower tax rate than us. Four of those are resort, two in the mountain, two on the beach. Extremely much more, you know, percentile-wise increase of property evaluations are extremely different from ours. On a higher note, Iredell County is the only one that's not resort, and they're getting bleed over from Mecklenburg, Charlotte. Their property evaluations are three times what ours are. So you can go in and argue, I would, that their 46-cent tax rate still too high for them. But that's impressive. I don't care how you cut it. I mean, it took us years to get to keep those numbers where they are. Could we have done better? Yeah. Could we have done a heck of a lot worse? Heck yes. I think it's obvious. And then you get in and look at bond indebtedness out of those same 21 counties. There's only two out of 21 that's got a lower bond indebtedness than us. Two. And both of those have 76-cent tax rates and a 74, I think. And I called one of them. And their tax rate's 50% higher than it ought to be because they're just taking it from their citizens, putting it in the bank. And I told him that in a nice way. I said, the reason your fund balance is where it is, where you don't have much bond indebtedness, is that you're overtaxing the people. And he laughed. He said, don't come down here and tell anybody.
Don't let the secret out, right?
I think the truth's got to be there as to what we've done. And but if I knew better pricing tonight, I would be able to go back in and look at that 6% right. possible.
Well, whether
I would support a tax increase.
We still have 3 meetings before we have right. to final deadline to do this. So.
And I think
it needs to be that conversation with the school system also that about the fund balance. I get the point at somebody tonight that did that to me one meeting they had over there. But we won't call any names. I think that needs to be talked about.
If we're not ready at the May meeting to call for a public hearing for, June 4th, we still got that extra meeting. But it sounds like
you're honing in on it.
We're not taking the shotgun approach anymore. We're kind of narrowing it down, and again setting the framework and if we're agreeable to like raises, if we're agreeable to understand about the capital cuts, if we're agreeable to some of these things and say, yeah, let's see what you can make this work, then we can come back with you with a recommended budget at the next meeting.
Is there a possibility of a work session, though?
Anytime.
And
that may work good, Tim, before we can sit down and actually look at this before we really start making decisions.
Well, we got to brainstorm every possible scenario and put everything on the table. And, I think we ought to do it in front of the public. Press would be there.
Yeah.
But bottom line is,
when would you like?
I'm not saying.
Anytime we can do that.
Well, what I would suggest is go ahead and do what Tim suggested,
right.
come in with some different
right.
options. And I think what I'm hearing Tim say is, rather than try to do this in a regular meeting.
Do a workshop.
Well, with all the different, basically right. sensitivity analysis. Let's make it 5, make it 6, make right. it 7% on the allocation changes and see what effect that has and what's the result in.
Some numbers.
Right.
Yeah. And that probably would be better served
right.
in a work session.
Okay.
I don't think we should try to schedule that right now. I think that's what Tori's for.
Just work, Tori.
But we'll try to have something within the next 2 weeks before our next meeting.
Is that all right there, buddy?
Sure.
And you know I'm going on the cruise.
Well, you need to tell her the dates. Okay. Thank you, Craig. Update on excess county property. What do you have for us?
We've really looked at and appreciate the work of our legal staff, Clyde and Ben. We really have 2 properties that we have that we are really excess and that we could get rid of. One is the obvious one in Grand Manor. We purchased that in 2009 for $550,000. We have looked at even the cost of what it would take to demolish the building. And I think that's got to be an option to look at, because we're getting water damage on a daily basis. They're getting windows broken on a daily basis. So there's some carrying costs that we do have for that property.
There's nothing in the building, right?
Junk.
Are we using it for storage?
No. I don't think it's dry enough to use it for storage, is it?
No, I mean, we're not storing any of our things in there. There may be some stuff that's left over from when it was the previous owner
had a nursing home or whatever. Yeah,
furniture and stuff in there, but we haven't been using it for our own storage.
Right.
I understand.
But if we demolish it, that's about $200,000. There may be some asbestos issues, but about $200,000. And talking with Clyde, if there's not a desire or a specific need, we could look at basically advertising for sealed bids and put a reserve in there about how much, would be our minimum. We don't have to say that. I have had a conversation, Eddie may have.
I talked with the mayor several times about the building. They have an interest, and actually when Craig and I were discussing maybe what we need to do with it, he said, well, maybe Graham would have an interest because they do own the ball field. And
I was going to ask, they have the rec center,
and
they
all
have
that.
The ballpark, ball mm-hmm. court over to the right.
Yeah, and there is interest from their board, I think, mm-hmm. to
Good.
Maybe look at it. And
I think it would, go ahead.
And Craig and I were just talking of how maybe we could work with them to make that happen, but. Of course, it's the board's decision.
I think it'd be a mistake to sell it. That's a bunch of land, and the location is worth $500,000. that land is for future development for the county. I think it'd be a mistake to sell it.
When we were you on the board when we okay yeah. We were in closed session on that, and David was county manager. Now this is my recollection of it, that you know the investment was not really for the building, it was for the land. I mean there was no talk
where can you get 3 acres of land that close to the county seat for $500,000? You're talking about we got a whole world ahead of us. You know, I think it'd be a mistake to sell 3 acres of land that close within 2 blocks from this building right here. I think it'd be a mistake.
But I'm not for renovating it though for county offices.
The problem is you got such a liability sitting with that building. I mean, the way I see it, if a child get up in there and get hurt, killed, whatever, it's gonna fall back on us.
I drove around back today, and there's beer bottles back there.
It's a liability, the building, and we don't have $200,000 to take it down. So, and
it certainly won't.
And you know, maybe in some talking with Graham, we could do some swap out somewhere, which is something we had talked of too. And you know, if they want the land, I don't know what the possibilities
are. See, at one time they were going to widen the street through there. I thought, and you know how you make it sharp curve at the left at the church and swing back to your right and go across the tracks. At one time, they were going to open all that up.
They would.
And I like to know the status of that. You know, all this, it could all fall into place for everybody, really.
And part of that was from Burlington. So
that's true.
I think they put all of that on Mebane Street is what I think happened at that time. Because I remember
place
that
is not costing us anything to leave it alone. I'd say, in my opinion, I think we'd be making a big mistake to sell that piece of property. When the county is certainly going to expand, more people are coming.
With what?
You got to think about the future. We got to
have some money.
Well, when Obama gets out the White House and quits screwing everything up, things are going to get better.
What's your other piece of property?
Is the nursing home on Woody Drive? You know, about a year and a half ago, we released that site. We do have the option of selling. The most important thing about the nursing home there are the beds with the certificate of need. The building is antiquated. Something's going to have to be done with the building for a modern nursing home. That's probably not. Is that a fair statement, Clyde?
I think it's a fair statement.
They're going to have to either put a lot of money into that site that they may not want to if they don't own it, or they're going to have to buy the beds from us and build somewhere else. So,
I know we just renewed that lease recently. What's the term of it now?
$440,000 for 5 years, and then there's an option after that for 5 years, and then an option after that for 5 years. However, and Clyde and I have had a couple of conversations about this, they may be interested in getting out of the lease if they knew that they could get the beds, and there may be, you know, more than one way to skin this cat. If we could just be authorized by the board to approach them about seeing that they have any interest in the beds or any interest in purchasing the site, or what we could work out a little bit differently than what we have now, if the board so chooses.
Well, let me understand. They could purchase the beds, though, and move to a different facility.
And then we sell on the property.
Leave us a piece of property.
That's what Graham Manor did. That's how we bought it for $550.
Yeah. So
I think any information as far as doing your homework would be worthwhile.
Yeah. But with the board's approval, we will approach them and see if there's different ways they would like to maybe do that.
Do we need formal approval, or can we do this by consensus?
We can take a look at it with the board's approval and come back to you with several options.
So you want formal approval?
You want a motion?
At least a
consensus.
Consensus.
Yes.
So we can go forward.
I don't have a problem.
Anybody not in favor of at least getting some information on
that?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Okay. And the other property we looked at were just pump stations and really not anything. They're just very small slithers of property that was not worth the effort in trying to
Well, on this Graham Manor, I'm thinking about this a little bit more. Okay, we're looking at $200,000 to take it down. We paid how much for it, Clyde?
$550,000.
$550,000, okay, that's $750,000. And Gerald, how much is that on the books for?
$900,000.
Now, do you feel that's a good estimate for that piece of property?
Something wrong with your hand.
It, now, if the board is agreeable, and not to say we could formally approach Graham, I think there's been some just initial discussions, but we could approach Graham to see if they have any interest, if that, you know, just to see what is
Did
there.
You mean in the old school building?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Just to see, just to formally request from the board, that may be an option.
I think that'd be a mistake.
Yeah. Wow.
You got to think of the future. This is a growing county. It would be stupid to sell that piece of property. We own it. It's not costing anything. I think it'd be a mistake to do anything.
No offense. I mean, you know, I'd like to know what it's
right.
And then I'm 62 years old. I can make a decision as to whether I want to do it or not.
Right.
And, you know, I would like to see their information.
It would. If we did that, it would mean probably mean more from a letter from the chairman to the mayor and saying, you know, it, you know, are there any interest? Right. And at least gauge it from that to see if we could move ahead or not. If that's okay with you.
Well, whatever the board
it's
consensus is.
I'm good with that.
And that's
all
I have. But again, we will work with you probably the first part of next week on trying to setting up some type of workshop on this budget.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Kim, okay. I'm glad you suggested
Not that. With me.
Well,
it's carnival here.
We'll put you on a speakerphone.
Yeah. Yeah.
From the carnival?
From the Aloha Day.
Is that all you
have? Yeah. Yes, sir.
Commissioner, comments? Any announcements? If not, thank you all for being here. We stand adjourned.
Oh, wait.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.